We start on equation 38, number I, 46 liter of helium gas at 25 degrees Celsius and 1 atmosphere was mixed with 12 liter of oxygen at 25 degrees Celsius and 1 atmosphere. During the mixing, both gases were pumped into a tank with a volume of 5 liter. Calculate the partial pressure of each gas and the total pressure in the tank at 25 degrees Celsius. That means that they combine the helium with 46 liter with oxygen, which has 12 liter, and they combine the two gas into a 5 liter container, a tank with 5 liter. So they have compressed the two gas together. So that means that each gas is exerting its partial pressure. Then we have a partial pressure of helium and you have a partial pressure of oxygen in 5 liter tank. And the mixing had 25 degrees Celsius. That means that after mixing the helium and the oxygen, the tank was having a 5 liter and at 25 degrees Celsius. We need to calculate the partial pressure of each gas and total pressure in the tank at 25 degrees Celsius. What we need to calculate as partial pressure, we need to use the ID gas law. We know that the total pressure will be the partial pressure of helium plus the partial pressure of oxygen. Then the partial pressure will be equal to number of mole times Z, the gas constant times temperature over the volume. That comes from the PV is equal to nRT, then pressure is equal to nRT over V. With partial pressure of helium, it means we need to have the number of mole of helium times the gas constant times temperature over the volume. The same as partial pressure for oxygen, we use the number of mole of oxygen times the gas constant, the temperature over the volume. So if then we can add them, the total pressure will be equal to a number of mole of helium, RT over V, plus the number of mole of oxygen, RT over V. If then we can put the number of mole together, the number of mole of helium plus the helium plus the number of mole of oxygen together, then we have the last formula that you can see where we have combined the number of mole of helium and number of mole of oxygen together. Then we multiply with the R, which is the gas constant, and the temperature over the volume. Let's see, determine first the mole of helium. We know number of mole is equal to PV over RT. So the pressure is 1 atmosphere. The volume of helium is 46 liter. The gas constant, then times the 298 Kelvin, that is the temperature that you have changed to Kelvin. Then we get 1.9 mole for the helium. We also calculate the mole of oxygen. By also taking PV over RT, we know we have 1 atmosphere and the oxygen is 12 liter, and then the gas constant, we replace also the temperature that was changed to Kelvin. Then we get 0.5 mole of oxygen. After getting the moles of helium and the mole of oxygen, we need to determine the partial pressure. The partial pressure, we have seen the formula that the partial pressure is equal to the number of mole times the gas constant times temperature over volume. But that partial pressure will be in the new container. That means that we use the 5 liter as volume of the tank. And then the temperature also is 25 degrees Celsius. That means after replacing the values, we will get 9.3 atmosphere for the partial pressure of helium. Then we move to a partial pressure of oxygen. We also use the number of mole of oxygen times the gas constant times temperature over the volume. Remember also that we need to use the volume of the tank. They have put the two gas in a 5 liter tank, so we use the volume of 5 liter. Each gas exerts its partial pressure. Then the two partial pressure of oxygen and helium, when they come together, they consume the total pressure. And replacing the values, then we get 2.4 atmosphere as a partial pressure for the oxygen. Then the total pressure, we can add the partial pressure of helium to the partial pressure of oxygen, and we get 11.7 atmosphere. Then after, then we can also use the formula where a total pressure is equal to the sum of the number of mole in the tank, then times the RT over V. If we do also, we get the same answer as 11.7 atmosphere. Let's move to number II. Partial pressure of oxygen was observed to be 146 torr in air with a total atmospheric pressure of 743 torr. Calculate the mole fraction of oxygen present. So here we have the partial pressure of oxygen, and you have also the total pressure, and we know a mole fraction of oxygen that we need to calculate will be equal to mole of oxygen dividing with the total moles. That is the mole fraction, the moles of oxygen dividing with the total mole. If then we are taking the mole of oxygen, that means that the mole will be equal to PV over RT. That means that the pressure, the partial pressure of oxygen times V over RT, then we get the mole fraction of the we get the mole of oxygen. Then after, because the oxygen is in the air, it is together with other content. So the air might be having carbon dioxide, might be having other gases, it might be having, apart from oxygen, it might be having nitrogen and other gases. Then that means that the partial pressure that we have, if we have the partial pressure that has oxygen, other gases also, they have the partial pressure in the air. Then we have the total pressure, which means the total pressure, which is the pressure combining oxygen together with other gases. Then as a mole fraction, it means we are taking the moles of oxygen dividing with the total mole. That means that the moles of oxygen will be pressure of oxygen times V over RT. Then the total mole also will be in the denominator. So we are dividing the moles of oxygen PV RT, which means the pressure of oxygen, plus pressure of X2, so that is the gas which is in the air that we don't know, PV, it's a pressure times V over RT, plus also the third gas that we don't know. Also we add the number of more up to the any gas, so the mixture of gas which are in the air, so we combine them, then we add them the number of more, then we take the moles of the oxygen dividing with the total moles of this gas in the air. If we are then we can put together the V over RT in the denominator, then we remain with the pressure of oxygen dividing with the pressure of other gas. If you can put the pressure of other gas together, then the VRT will cancel, then you remain with pressure of oxygen over a total pressure. That means that the mole fraction of any gas is equal to the partial pressure of that oxygen of that gas. In this case, we have oxygen dividing the total pressure. So that is the formula that we'll be using. If we have the partial pressure and you have the total pressure, then you can determine the mole fraction by also, rather than using the moles, you can use the partial pressure and of that gas and the total pressure. Then here, with the mole fraction of oxygen will be equal to 156 torr, which is the partial pressure of oxygen, dividing with 743 torr, which is the total pressure. Then we get 0.21 more as the mole fraction of oxygen. The third sub-question, the mole fraction of nitrogen in the air is 0.7808. Calculate the partial pressure of nitrogen in the air when the atmospheric pressure is 706 torr. So here we have now the mole fraction. We need to use the formula. We know that the mole fraction is equal to a partial pressure dividing with the total pressure. Here we have nitrogen. This means that the mole fraction of nitrogen is equal to the partial pressure of nitrogen dividing with the total pressure. Then the partial pressure of nitrogen will be equal to the mole fraction of nitrogen that was given times the total pressure that was also given in torr. So then here we need to multiply the mole fraction of nitrogen times the atmospheric pressure, which is total pressure. Then we get partial pressure of nitrogen, which will be equal to 593 torr. So going to the next question, a sample of solid potassium chlorate was heated in a test tube and decomposed by giving potassium chloride and oxygen. So which means it was decomposed giving the oxygen and potassium chloride. The oxygen produced was collected in water at 22 degrees Celsius and at the total pressure of 75 foot-torps. That means that they have decomposed the chemical decomposed giving the oxygen, and the oxygen which is collected, the oxygen which is produced was collected in water. So this means it was dissolved in water. So creating the will be having then the partial pressure of water and the partial pressure of oxygen, the mixture of oxygen and water. The volume of gas collected in water was this. So this means the volume of the gas that was collected from the decomposition was 0.65 liter in water. And the vapor pressure of water at 22 degrees centigrade is 21 torr. So that means that we have the total pressure, which is 75 torr. And then we have also the partial pressure of water. So the vapor pressure of water, if you have then the partial pressure of water, then we can calculate the partial pressure of oxygen that was asked. They're asking calculate the partial pressure of oxygen, the gas collected. They're asking also to calculate the number of mole of the collected oxygen, and they are asking to calculate the mass of potassium chlorate in the sample that was decomposing, the original sample. So for the partial pressure or the pressure of oxygen in the water is very simple here. We know the total pressure is equal to partial pressure of water plus partial pressure of oxygen. So there will be the total pressure will be equal to the partial pressure of water plus partial pressure of oxygen. Then to get partial pressure of oxygen, we take the total minus the partial pressure of water. Then we get the partial pressure of oxygen, which is 0.964 atmosphere. Of course, because here we have torr, we have converted to a atmosphere by dividing with 760 torr per atmosphere. After getting the partial pressure, then we can determine the mole of oxygen. The mole of oxygen that was asked will be equal to PV over RT. The pressure we have calculated, the volume we have is 0.65, the gas constant, and we have also the temperature, and we get 0.0259 mole. Then for us to get the mass of potassium chlorate that was originally decomposed, we need to have the balanced equation, and with this balanced equation we have that 2 mole of potassium chlorate produce 2 mole of potassium chloride plus 3 mole of oxygen. That means that 3 mole of oxygen are produced by 2 mole of potassium chlorate. Then if 3 mole of oxygen are produced by 2 mole of potassium chlorate, then this mole, 0.0259 mole of oxygen was produced by this amount of mole of potassium chlorate. So we need to take 2 dividing by 3 times 0.0259 to get the number of mole of potassium chloride that produced 0.0259 mole of oxygen. Then after getting the moles to get the mass, then we take the mole times the molar mass. The molar mass of potassium chloride is 122.6 gram per mole. Then we get 2.12 gram of potassium chloride. Going to the next question, sub question 5, derive the formula for calculating the average kinetic energy of the ID gas and the formula for calculating the room mean square velocity for the gas. Using the derived formula, calculate the root mean square velocity for the atoms in a sample of helium gas at 25 degrees Celsius. Here we need to derive the two formula. The first one is the average kinetic energy of ID gas, and the second formula is the root mean square velocity for the gas. And then they're asking to use the formula for root mean square velocity, then to calculate the root mean square velocity of the atom in the sample of helium. The temperature was given as 25 degrees Celsius. So here we will start with calculating the average kinetic energy. We know that the kinetic energy of one particle is equal to 1 over 2 mass, so which means the mass of individual particle times the square of the velocity. Then for one more, so if now this is the mass, the kinetic energy for one particle, but for one more, a more is equal to the Avogadro's number of particles. So in that case, the average kinetic energy, if we are taking the one more, so we need to multiply with the Avogadro's number, which is the number of particles in one more. So for one more, then we take a kinetic energy, average kinetic energy. In that case, because you have many particles, we do the average kinetic energy, and the average kinetic energy will be equal to the that is the NA, the, is the Avogadro's number times the 1 over 2 m times mu square. This mu is the average of the square of the velocity of the particle, which means we have a velocity of the particles. Then we square the velocity of each particle, we square it, and then we do the average. So average of the square of the velocities. So that means that we need to calculate the square of the velocities, and then we do the average of the square of the velocities. Then the NA is the Avogadro's number. Then here we have the average kinetic energy in one mole. So that is the average kinetic energy of one mole. The pressure of ideal gas in the container, if you have in the container, is proportional to this average kinetic energy, because the kinetic energy will cause the mole particles to move, and the particle, they are going to exert the pressure to the container, and then it is inversely proportional also to the volume of the container. So it's directly proportional to the average kinetic energy and inversely proportional to the volume of the container. So if you have the container, then the pressure of the gas in the container will be proportional to the average kinetic energy of the gas that we have calculated before, and we have demonstrated the formula how to calculate the average kinetic energy of the gas. And the formula that we have demonstrated above, it means it is directly proportional to the pressure, and it is the pressure is inversely proportional to the volume of the container. Then if you are replacing the formula NA, the Avogadro's number, 1 over 2 m mu square, so here we get the kinetic, average kinetic energy. Then after getting kinetic energy, that N, because the pressure is not exerted by one mole, we need to multiply with that N. N is the number of moles, because the pressure in the tank is not exerted by only one mole. That's why we need to multiply N as the number of more moles. That means that the pressure is equal to 2 over 3. That over 3 is the proportionality constant. I told you that if they are telling you that there is a proportionality, is proportional to the average kinetic energy, there should be a proportionality constant. Then in that case, we have PV is equal to 2 over 3 N, the kinetic average kinetic energy, because we take V multiply for the pressure on the other side. Then we have PV, if we, then we can divide the N on the one side, the PV over N is equal to 2 over 3, the kinetic times the average kinetic energy. Then by having this PV over N is equal to 2 over 3 average kinetic energy. So remember, in the formula of I Diggers law, we have PV is equal to NRT. Then we can take PV dividing with N is equal to RT. So then you can replace this PV over N by RT. So that means that RT will be equal to 2 over 3 times the average kinetic energy. Then by replacing, by multiplying 3 to the first term, that will be 3 RT, which is equal to 2 times the average kinetic energy. Then you can determine the average kinetic energy, which is equal to 3 over 2 RT, according to, by rearranging the formula that you can see on the screen. Now we have the formula of the average kinetic energy, which is equal to 3 over 2 RT. So far you have the average kinetic energy, which is equal to 3 over 2 RT. We have also the average kinetic energy, which is equal also to the number of Avogadro, to the Avogadro's number, times the 1 over 2 m mu square. Then in that case, we can replace the formula of average kinetic energy by 3 over 2 RT. Then we get N over 2 mu m mu square. So then if you can multiply 2 on the other side, you will get 6 over 2 RT, which is equal to Avogadro's number times the mass of one particle times mu square. And that's mu that you can see mu square, that's the mean square of velocity. So that's the mean square of the velocity. We square of the velocity and then we do the mean. Then this mean square velocity will be equal to 3 RT over Avogadro's number times m. So that after we need to find then this mean square of velocity, then it will be equal to 3 RT over Avogadro's number times n. Then the question we're asked to determine the root mean square of velocity. So we need to determine then the root mean of mean square of the velocity. Then after putting the root mean, then the root of the mu square, then we get a root of 3 RT over Avogadro's number times n. And this Avogadro's number times n, that is the molar mass. Here we use the molar mass in kilogram per mole, so that we will be getting the root mean square velocity in meter per second. And then we are changing the unit of R constant. We don't use the in liter atmosphere per mole Kelvin here because we want to get the velocity in meter per second. Here we are going to use the R constant, which is in joule per mole Kelvin. So then we have the root mean square velocity, which is equal to a square root of 3 RT over molar mass. Of course, that's the molar mass of the gas, molar mass in kilogram per mole. So remember, if the molar mass is the mass of one particle, which is m, then times the particle in one mole. And the particle in one mole, that is the Avogadro's number. That is where Na times m, that is why Na, Avogadro's number times m, which is the mass of one particle, is equal to molar mass. Then we need also to calculate the root mean square velocity of the gas that was given. In that case, we take 3 R and the temperature, dividing with the molar mass. The molar mass of helium now we have is 4. Then we need to change in kilogram by dividing at 1000. Then we have the root mean square velocity of 1.36 times 10 power 3 meter per second. What is the difference between diffusion and effusion? As the next question. Diffusion, when we are talking about diffusion, we are talking about the mixing of gas. Diffusion describes the mixing of gas. When we have two gases, when a small amount of smelling gas, and have a smelling gas, when it is released in the area, in a particular area, it takes time for it to smell the gas. To then, because it takes time for the gas to mix with air, the gas mix with air, and then it will reach you, and that's where you have to smell the gas after the gas mixed with air and it is reached. That's what you call diffusion. Diffusion is the rate of mixing of gases. Contrary to effusion, effusion is the term used to describe the passage or transfer of a gas through a thin orifice into a chamber. So when a gas is passing through a thin orifice into a chamber, in that case, that is effusion. The rate of fission measure the speed by which that gas is passing or it is transferring through a chamber, passing through a thin orifice. If you check on the schematic diagram, then the gas is passing through the pinhole to reach the vacuum. Then the gas is passed through that barrier, but the barrier must have the orifice, the small pinhole where it is passing. And passing there, of course, if the mass of the gas is too is higher, then it will be difficult for the gas to pass. So then effusion of the gas is inversely proportional to the mass. If the mass is big, it will be difficult for the gas to pass, the gas molecule to pass. Next question asking, explain the Graham's law of effusion and calculate the ratio of the effusion rate of hydrogen gas and uranium hexafluoride. The heat of effusion of a gas is inversely proportional to the square root of the mass of its particle. So it's inversely proportional to the square root of the mass of the particle. Of course, it should be it should have an inverse relationship to the mass of its particle, because during the effusion, the gas is passing through a thin orifice. Graham's law of fusion also says that the relative rate of effusion of two gases, if you have two gases at the same temperature and pressure, they are given by the inverse ratio of the square root of the mass of the gas particle. So then we need to take the mass, and then we are going to have the inverse of the square roots of their mass. So that means that rate of fusion of gas 1 over the rate of fusion of gas 2 will be equal to 1 over square root of m1 dividing with 1 over square root of m2. So that means the first gas and the second, that when we are talking about the mass, we are talking about the mass of the molar mass of the first gas dividing with the molar mass of the second gas. That's why, but we need to use the inverse, the inverse ratio of the square roots. That's why you can see that you have 1 over square root of m1 over 1 over square root of m2. So this means you need to have an inverse. Then at the end, we get that the rate of effusion of gas 1 dividing the rate of effusion of gas 2 will be equal to a square root of m2 over m1. Here we are going to use the molar mass and not the mass as it is. This m is the molar mass. M2, that will be for gas 2 over m1 for gas 1. That is the Graham's law of diffusion. Then M1 and M2 represent the molar mass of the gases. I told you that we are going to use the molar mass. Then the molar mass of hydrogen gas is 2.016 gram per molar, and the molar mass of this compound is 342.2 gram per molar. Then if you have the rate of fusion, it will be rate of fusion of hydrogen to the rate of fusion of the second gas. That will be equal to a square root of m2 over m1, or a square root of muf6 over m hydrogen. Then in that case, it will be equal to square root of 352.2 gram per mole dividing with 2.016 gram per mole. Here we will get 13.2 as the rate of effusion. So you take the square root of the m2, the molar mass of the second gas, dividing with the molar mass of the first gas that was given. Using the ammonia and HCl as example, calculate the diffusion. Explain why a quantitative analysis of diffusion requires a more complex analysis, and why it is complicated to describe the diffusion of gases theoretically. Here we might expect that the distance traveled by the two gases are related to the relative velocity of the gas molecule. So then if the gas are traveling, you might expect that the distance they will travel, it will depend of course on the roots mean square of the velocity. So we expect that they are related to the relative velocity of the gas molecules. Of course, normally the distance should be related to the velocity of the gas molecule. So that means that distance traveled by the ammonia over distance traveled by the HCl will be equal to the velocity of ammonia and also the mean root mean square of HCl. Then that means that square root of molar mass of the second gas over the square root over the square root of molar mass of the first gas. That means that we have the molar mass of HCl as the second gas over the molar mass of the ammonia as the first gas. But we need to put the square root. And then that means that it will be equal to, the diffusion will be equal to 36.5 gram per mole dividing with 17 gram per mole. That will give 1.5. Then the problem is that the careful experiment has revealed that the value is not 1.5 as such, but it is less than 1.5, indicating that a quantitative analysis of diffusion requires a more complex analysis, because this kind of calculation cannot give you the true value of the diffusion, or it cannot give you the good indication of the diffusion. This is because so many collision occurs in gas. A gas is colliding with the air. Then the diffusion is quite complicated to describe theoretically because of so many collision occurring in the gas colliding with air. So it will take several minutes for the ammonia and the hydrochloric molecule to meet because either ammonia will take time colliding with the air, and HCA will also take time colliding with air. Then it will take several minutes for the ammonia and the HCA molecule to meet. So that have a complication because many collision occurring when gas mix, this makes diffusion very complicated to estimate theoretically. So that was the question for today. Thank you for your kind attention. The next topic will be question and answer in thermochemistry. This is the contact address, my contact address. Please don't forget to subscribe, like, and share to support us so that next time also you'll be getting the series of a question regarding a chemistry calculation.